Move support for proposal seeks approval from the Boston Mayor of redevelopment authority for Arden Lane large project relief because it is greater than 50,000 square feet. All projects greater than 50,000 gross square feet in the city of Boston are required to go to Arden Lane large project review. That's why we're here tonight. A project notification form, which we call a PNF, is submitted to the Boston Redevelopment Authority on September 15th, setting off a 30-day public comment period required under Arden Lane. As part of that public process, we've assembled an impact advisory group with help from all local elected officials. We have had three impact advisory group meetings thus far, one held under official project layer review. We are also required for a scoping session at the MRA, which we had last week, which a couple IAG members wanted to set. We are also required for a public meeting, which is why we are here tonight. This was broadcast in the local papers. Thank you. As well as NorthEndWaterfront.com. I do want to acknowledge that NorthEndWaterfront.com is filming this meeting tonight. So we thank Matt Conti for his participation in this as well. This meeting tonight will be critical to this project going forward. The BRA is very eager to hear how the public feels about this project. We've had a few meetings, but we've yet to have a true public forum where we can solicit feedback from the North End as a whole. We know this is a very important project for the North End and the North End waterfront. We've received about 300 public comments thus far. That's quite high. We expect to get many more over the next week until the public comment period closes on October 15th. I want to reiterate a few things that I've said at our IAG meetings and go on the record with these statements. The BRA is not showing you this project tonight, but we're bringing endorsement and telling you that it is set in stone. This is under review of the BRA. All we have told the proponent is that we are okay with them submitting the project and going through the process. This process vets the project on many different levels, and the BRA will determine whether we're going to bring it forward to our board for approval or not based on how this process goes. There's multiple factors that go into that determination, including how meetings like this go, how the public comments received tell us how the community feels about it, how our elected officials feel about it. So this is an open public forum. We are eager to hear how you all feel about this tonight. I want to reiterate something else that can go on record that I stated at the last meeting. This project is very much under review. It is under review for urban design, zoning conformity, and legality. These are all still being vetted and analyzed thoroughly. We understand that the proponent believes the project is as of right. We have not made a determination on that yet. Inspectional Services is the city agency that will ultimately make that determination, but this is still under review for legality and zoning conformity. Again, public will is critical in determining if we're going to bring it forward or not, so we want to hear how you feel about this. Whether you support it, whether you oppose it, whether you like certain aspects of the project, or you like to see certain aspects changed. Tonight is an appropriate forum to tell the BRA or proponent how you feel. Anything that doesn't come to mind tonight, you can obviously submit a public comment period, which will be open for another week. So how this is going to work tonight, I'm going to hand it off to the proponent in a minute. I'm going to ask that they come through their presentation. It should take them about 15 minutes. Then it's an open forum. We're basically just going to have a receiving line in the middle aisle, as you see the microphone there. Whoever gets up first will have an opportunity to speak. If you have a comment, you can say it. If you have a question for either the city or the proponent, you'll have an opportunity to ask it. We'll have an opportunity to answer. In the sake of time, I ask that you please, please work with us. Keep your comments or questions to 2 minutes at maximum. We don't want to cut anybody off. We want to give everybody an opportunity to speak. So it's vital that you keep your comments to 2 minutes and no longer. I'll be up here to give a time check warning if you're coming up in 2 minutes. As far as next step go, public comment period closes on October 15th, at which time the BRA will make a determination on next steps. We have not determined next steps at this point. We need to see how this meeting goes. We need to continue to monitor the public comments that come in. I'm going to pass out a signing sheet at the moment. I ask that you please sign in and leave your email address. Email address is most pertinent. That's how we're going to communicate. information at the bottom. You can simply email the public comments to me directly. We share that with the DRC staff. We read every comment that comes in, so please keep sending it. Okay, I think that's it for me. I'm going to hand it over to Daniel Toscano, SIDH for the team briefly, and then we'll take it from there. Thank you, okay?
Thank you, Chris. Again, my name is Dan Toscano. I'm a development team here to present the proposal for this walk for the development in the area.
Hello?
Here you go. Again, my name is Dan Toscano. I'm a development team for the Lewis Walk project. First, I want to say thank you for everybody coming out tonight. As Chris mentioned, this is the fourth time we meet Fridays and meet with the community as a whole. And Chris was very important to the project. I want to thank everybody for being here tonight. We've gone through this project with our team. We feel that this is 100% compliant plan. Before I introduce the team, what we want to do is to bring back the access to the water. What we want to do is develop this area that's been dilapidated for many years. We want to create a beautiful park for our neighborhood, the city of Boston, and get rid of the eyesore surface parking lot. We want to beautify that area and in turn create some jobs for our neighborhood, for our city of Boston, and beautify the entire city of Boston. We want that. We're going to take a few minutes. I'll introduce our team. We'll put the plan. Will Adams from the JW Capital Partners, BJ Moriarty from the JW Capital.
Thank you, Dave. Can everyone hear me okay? So thank you everyone for coming. We're very excited to present the hotel and the Lewis Wharf parcel in our first public meeting. As many of you know, we've just started the public process. We're 3 weeks into the public process. And we know that there's a lot of process to go through, and we look forward to working with the community and folks in the community as we go through the next coming months and possibly years. So I'm going to give you a brief overview of the proposal. Many of you are familiar with the site. You know, one of the important things about waterfront development is maintaining access for all. We feel very strongly that this proposal enables complete access for everyone to enjoy Boston Harbor and the waterfront around it. We're going to walk through a brief overview of the proposal. As you know, this is the existing surface parking lot site where the two hotel buildings are. They're both on existing pile fields that are in Boston Harbor. If you have anything to add, feel free.
Sure, two points. First of all, just for context, we have the pilot house on the lower left side of the screen. In the center of the screen is the Lewis Wharf condominium building. Lower right side of the screen is the Prince building, and then of course there's commercial wharf up at the top. These are computer-generated images that are to scale. One other point, just a general point before we get deeper into the presentation. This is a large screen. We've attempted to make these renderings visible as possible. I'll answer colors and answer questions and leave that for a while to learn about the project. If when asking a question, it would be helpful to take a look at any boards, whether you're a fan of the project, a fan of the project, or maybe of your mind, or if you want to take our mic, point out the images up close if that's helpful. The goal here again is to answer all questions.
Thanks, Tom. I think we should go through the highlights that we have. The hotel is a 277-key hotel.
creating 2.5 acres of open pedestrian space around the site and 1.25 acres of public park. Everything in the hotel is publicly accessible. Where the surface parking lot is, we're going to drop below grade into 379 car parking garage. Key component of this parking garage is currently 223 public spaces that serve the Fort Bend. We do not want to take those out of service. We want to maintain public parking at the site and build the additional required parking, 156 spaces for the hotel. This is a view of the hotel looking west. Highlighting from this, you can see access to the harbor walks surrounding the building, our glass connector building, which is really a community room, space for people to come and enjoy the waterfront flowing out to the harbor.
Folks, just one comment on context. Because the site is approximately 9 acres, the building height is 55 feet, there's actually quite a bit of build-out that's possible on the site. A first pass of this project involved two wings and then a central building, which is the same height as the wings, which would have complied with the zoning requirements in terms of height and development of the site. But looking at the footage, we realized the impact that would have been used for the lowest part of the building. And so it's necessary to have a connection for all sorts of weather between the buildings for hotel guest comfort. But we realized that it would be better to lower middle piece, making lasting transparent. It's one story with an elevated and high and one story building with sound. The goal was to lower that central element and actually reduce the potential build up of the site to respect our neighbors to the lowest floor building.
So this is a site plan of the site. We want to walk you through the various programming aspects of the parcel. Again, this is where we're showing the sailing pavilion. One thing we haven't mentioned is the creation of a permanent home in the Boston Sailing Center. In this area, this is a public park flowing down to the water, and all around this building is a connectivity to the water. You can go all the way through these glass buildings, around, out to a waterfront terrace, harbor walk with a lot of seating around it. And one thing over here, currently the pool in Lewis Wharf is in this area. We need to relocate that pool, and by doing the relocation of the pool, we're able to actually create a true harbor walk that does not exist out there. This is the existing conditions. As many of you know, it's a surface parking lot. Dilapidated pilot fields in the home of the Boston Sailing Center. I'm going to walk you through some photos of the existing conditions that are out there as we speak. This is the pile field on the south of the wharf. This is the area by the north wharf. This is if you're on Atlantic Ave looking back towards the parking lot, you can see the kiosk where cars travel in and out of the surface parking lot. Again, more photos of parking from Atlantic Ave. We'll bring you back to this overview of the proposal. So we've talked a lot about connectivity to the water, water access for all. There's a lot of other important community benefits that come out of a project like this. Importantly, we talk about jobs. There's 150 permanent jobs. Real living wage jobs that get derived out of a project like this. 300 construction jobs. 7.4 million in city and state tax revenues. I think it's important to note here the mayor just made an initiative to spend $1 billion on public schools in the city of Boston. Okay? This project alone generates $4 million in taxes and revenue to the city of Boston. Without projects like this, we can't fund schools in the city of Boston.
Oh, so this is what the $7.4 million in annual real estate taxes in context. I have three children who attend the Boston Public School System. They here for K to 8 school, serves 893 kids, about 700 families. The annual budget for that school is $7.5 million. We have a currently underfunded school system, and a program like this is sorely needed, and we need much, much appreciated.
Other highlights of the project that we have already talked about, 1,800 feet when we connected Harbor Walk. New walkways providing access to and from the harbor, through the hotel, through community space. Again, this hotel will be all publicly accessible. Permanent home for the Boston Sailing Center. We want to keep the existing 223 parking spaces as a public amenity for the greater community. Like, it's important to note here, we all saw what the existing conditions sign is. Existing conditions are, by dropping 223 spaces below grade, there's a heat island effect that goes on without asphalt like that. By creating 1.25 acres of green space, it's going to greatly reduce the heat island effect that comes off of that site as we speak. And finally, we're opening up the water sheet, water taxis, short-term dock tie-ups, people coming in and out and using the harbor in a way that is currently not used there today. People ask about what's the building going to look like from a pedestrian perspective. So we're going to just walk quickly through some renderings of the proposal. This is on Atlantic Ave between the sailboat and on Lotus Wharf. This is, if you're sitting at an angle, you have the sidewalk coming up, the existing kiosk will be right about this location. Park on the left, access to the hotel lobby and down to the connector building in the foreground. This is if you're standing on the landing gap near the Starbucks. The idea is to have some exterior outdoor cafe type seating and inviting park to get people to come walk from the park, get down to the water, enjoy the water, enjoy the park. This is a perspective if you're basically up near the hotel entrance and know the harbor walk that connects all the way around. You can come and walk through. There's a myriad of ways to come and enjoy the building. This is at the end of your harbor walk if you're looking back at the connector building. And again, what we call the waterport terrace area, where there's a lot of water activity, bringing access to and from water taxis, short-term touch-and-go docks, etc. I'll turn this over to Don.
For those who can see this slide, it's a traffic comparison. There is a projected traffic number for the site, and there are no traffic figures for Battery Wharf. Many folks live in Battery Wharf just off the waterfront. Has 150 hotel rooms, it has 100 condominiums, therefore similar in size, similar in impact to this project. So although we're early on in the process and we're just beginning our in-depth study of traffic at the site, and as an aside, we've had a lot of helpful input from the neighbor residents on what we should look at. We do have a preliminary comparison here. The AM peak hour at Battery Wharf generates 100 cars at that time. Future Lewis Ford though will be 92 cars on the same morning peak hour. The evening peak hour, Battery Wharf generates 111 car trips to the site. The future Lewis Ford project will generate 136. Some folks look at this number and have a question, and the question could be, this is an almost 300-room hotel. Surely it's going to create more traffic than this. And the reason it doesn't is because think of when you check into a hotel in the past. Many hotel guests arrive between 11 and 3. If they can't get into your room before a certain point in the morning, checkout is typically midday as well. So there's an offsetting peak that a hotel has compared to, say, office use or retail use. If this is an office building, lots of people show up in the morning at the peak hour, an office building of comparable size. But the hotel is very different set of peaks and traffic, and a lot of that comes in the afternoon, so it doesn't add on to the morning and evening rush hour traffic as much.
From the harbor
Zipcar, Hubway, again, as Don was mentioning, hotels in the city of Boston do not generate 100% vehicular traffic. Okay, a lot of people come, they walk, they're going to be taking the water taxis here, we're going to have a water boat show from our property to the airport. And this just highlights various opportunities for public transit at this site.
This site shows the comparison of the height of the project to existing buildings in the area. There's also another reference building for scale. It's our sense that perhaps it's our fault that we haven't been sufficiently clear about the height of the building. We certainly heard people refer to a massive towering structure of the site. It's going to be 55 feet high. So you see comparisons here, just looking across. If you look at the far end, left side of the screen, that's a typical Boston Towers. And the red line runs across this roof gives you a sense of how tall the other buildings are in comparison to the south end, the back bay townhouse on a very walkable street. So human scale there, the folks understand, so we put that up to give you a sense of how these other buildings scale. Battery Wharf is next to it, approximately 55 feet high as well. Burroughs Wharf is taller, the Wild House is taller. The Lewis Wharf project, our hotel project, is center is almost dead even with the townhouse site, which is on the far left. The existing Lewis Wharf condominium building is more than 10 feet taller than our proposed building. The Prince building is approximately 126 feet, over twice as tall as our proposed building. And the commercial work building is slightly taller. A reason for some of the discussions around what the height of the project may be is that we have referred repeatedly to the base height of the building and then the height of the building measured above the base height. The base height out here on the waterfront is measured from local sea level, which is called Boston City Base. That's a sort of artificial height line that every building in this area gets measured from. Because of concerns about future sea level rise, the hotel project has to be built up slightly. If you look carefully at this site, you'll see there's a plinth underneath the building that's going to be raised up slightly above the existing grade at the wharf so that it is future-proof in terms of climate change. That red line shows the height of the building, again, compared to the Platinum House and the Lewis Wharf condominium building. This is the same length that anyone walking along these buildings would experience. You're standing on the ground and looking up, our building, including that raised base, will be 55 feet above where your shoe leather is touching.
We'll go briefly through this, but this is a comparison slide of all the area buildings in terms of heights and in terms of square footages. Not to pick on the Lewis Wharf condominium building, but it's the closest one. Building H here. You see over here the height of the Lewis Wharf condominium building to the roof line is 68 feet and to the penthouse is 82 feet. The square footage of the Lewis Wharf condominium building is 190,000 square feet. You can go and look at all the buildings along the area here and the heights. The next shortest building is Battery Wharf, 57 feet. I think it's important to note here that within this general area of this waterfront area, there's almost a million square feet of commercial space. This is a mixed-use residential commercial area. Many of you have seen this slide before. This site did not for previous approval project. It was called Gunman Proposal. It was fully approved by the BRA back in 1991 for a 335-key hotel and 570 subterranean parking spaces. At a full rate determination from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for a Chapter 91 license. This was the project as shown in the Harbor Park plan. The community went through a long planning process initiative of the Harbor Park plan, which we've talked about many times in recent months, but the bottom line is the current zoning for the site, Article 42A, adopted in 1990 as it was the outcome of the Harbor Park planning process. What led to the Harbor Park planning process was the dilapidation of the entire city of Washington waterfront. Going back in time, this is a shot of the site from 1931 with the pier configurations essentially the same as they are today, the pilot and the land and the structure of the grand building. There's a historical context that we do need to talk about. This site's been a commercial operation for 200 plus years. As an example of a license issued by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts back in 1887. As you can see, this is the location of the pilot fields. This is the grand current Lewis Ford condominium building. I think it's important to note that these sites for hundreds of years have been used as commercial operations. All the other piers and figure piers in the network from the city of Boston have been redeveloped. This is one of the last ones yet to be done. So finally, we're going to show you, we were asked about pedestrian view corridors. What does it look like today? And what does it look like when the proposal is finally built? Again, kiosk surface parking lot. This is the rendered view of that. This is if you're on the land gap near the Starbucks, looking back towards the harbor. This is the rendered view of that. This is if you're further up on the property, looking out towards the harbor. This is the rendered view of that. This is if you're on the land between, again, the sail off and one of those four, looking out towards the harbor. And this is the rendered view of that. Finally, we want to touch on the summary of benefits again. Just going to put them up. We don't need to walk through them. We all know what they are. So with that, we're going to turn this over back to Chris Grayson. Thank you, everyone.
The open space, if You notice the south side of those wharves, the place that Vivian Lee called one of the greatest spots in the harbor. They want to put a swimming pool right in the middle of it. That's no longer open space, so they'll fill the south side. The north side has a lot of grass now. It could be better, that's for sure. But it's not quite as simple. Last, the taxes and all the jobs that are coming are a good thing, but there are many, many, many hotels being built right now, and the city's getting a lot of new revenue. So I don't think that is a major factor for the city.
Thanks. Thanks, Chris. Thanks for being here.
One more point, the sailing center. There are 1,000 users in that sailing center. And the living in an old man for over 20 years. The major thing here that developed out of focus seeking is it's going to be a 300 person forum, 150 person restaurant.
Oh,
and that can be out traffic. Something that needs to be done by the business mission this evening. There's going to be a 300 person ballroom plus a 150 person restaurant. The noise and disruption and traffic that those local bring will be immense, and I think everybody will regret. It's interesting to note from the same stuff, it's interesting to note that the city of Boston presently fighting the wind casino in Everett on our north boundary over traffic impact. I therefore appeal to the BRA to seriously consider a similar impending issue over traffic, which they're going to need to address on the waterfront. I think that's about all I really want to say, except I really do not think 190,000 square feet, that's nearly 5 acres of extra built space on the waterfront, is going to help anyone. Thank you.
Safe to withstand weather conditions here. Thank you.
involved. This is not good. This is not a good project for the young man. I've been on the neighborhood council for over 20 years, and I've always felt as if I did this thing for the neighborhood. I also wanted to acknowledge our representative, Eric Michaels, and Anthony Pedicelli and Sal Martino, but actually opposing this project. They knew.
Supreme Court precedent, which says you cannot build a hotel on this particular parcel.
little bit more important than people discussing a traffic jam.
I live on this street. It's going to improve my neighborhood, it's going to improve my property value. interpretations of the law. Consensus does not even exist about how a specific site moves today. On the one hand, the developer's representatives, Don Toscano and Will Adams, have stated that the proposed site is an abandoned and dilapidated battlefield beside a hot top parking lot, a ghost town, an attempt at a harbor rock which does not meet current standards, and a dilapidated work of many, many years. On the other hand, Attorney Jamie Medea has stated that the property owner, Philip DeNormandy, has legal obligations to maintain a property which he has not.
By offering these, the club brings in hundreds change that. Thank you very much.
Respectfully,
disagree. I think that all, I think the architectural design is very powerful, not quite over there. Obviously, has a wonderful sense of aesthetics. The buildings are beautiful. The problem is that one of the existing beauties of this neighborhood is that you can walk along the water, not just looking straight out, as these photographs show, but from the north or from the south. You can walk for a long, long way, which I've been doing on my bicycle or running. Now that I'm getting kind of old, walking, I've been doing it for more than 30 years, and you can see the water all the way out from the entrance to the harbor. You're walking from north to south. If you're walking from south to north, you can see the Navy Yard for a long, long way. And if these buildings are built as lovely as they are, they're beautiful buildings, you're not going to be able to see the water. And, you know, I submit to all of you that everybody that I know who comes to this city loves it, whether they come here on business or they come here for pleasure. And one of the huge reasons that they love it is because the harbor is as beautiful as it is, just as the river adds enormous beauty and value to this city. And if we build these buildings, we're not going to be able to see the water anymore from the north or from the south, and neither of the folks who come here to visit. And that's what causes visitors to drop off. That has an effect on revenues. Finally, from just the perspective of living here, once the building, first of all, it's going to take a long time for the buildings to be built. And I'm not talking about litigation, I'm talking about just the practicality of building. The building is going to take a long time, and it's going to be disruptive. And that probably would be okay, except when it's over, when it's built, it's still going to be disruptive. Because, you know, however, I forget how many hotel rooms there are, 290, 250, 200, all those folks need to eat. And all the people who go to parties there, weddings, and restaurants, need to eat and they need to drink, and that means deliveries, it means a lot of trash, it means a lot of trucks at all hours of the day and the night.
What these people are trying to do. The fact that they're going to put, they're putting their
Barclay Marina. Why do we need a hotel to provide that?
Thank you. Number two, the traffic survey that you talked about, not possibly correct. I do a lot of traffic with my friends, so I don't see if they did borrow years back. I guarantee I keep on checking and check out at 2 p.m. I check out, I check in at 5 a.m., I check out at 9 a.m. Exactly.
food for thought. These are very entertaining developers, and while the existing owner has a more past and is not very entertaining, be careful what you wish for if something like this doesn't go forward. That park could be built. Just think about it. Imagine if you have one more of those apartments to go to school. So, the access to the water park, I've always been trying to champion because there's parts of the harbor walk that has to stop and be cut off. And one of them is Coast Guard, for one. This particular parcel is commercial. I would like to see a continued path of the harbor walk all the way around the harbor and be back. And I'll leave you with this. We want to be first class city. We want to be, think of the inner harbor of think of San Francisco, think of Vancouver. They do things very successfully on the waterfront, and you can live on the waterfront and have those additional uses against the water. So I'm very supportive of the project. I think it has a lot of good things going for it.
Gets to scoop the private profit at your expense. The law says maybe it could work. Just as I was thinking that a party boat went by with 10 people on it, could have been more than 10 people, and you could not believe the noise pollution. I stand here now and I think about the size of this venue and all the parties will take place and the restaurant, and there is no doubt in my mind that there will be noise pollution like nothing we've seen in our neighborhood. Point two, neighborhoods. I like our neighborhood. I support our neighborhood. And one of the things I really, really find so great about it is its commitment to the importance of neighborhoods in our city. And there's no gap between the noise and the traffic that will destroy the North Bend and waterfront area. Finally, number three, the BRA. I do not believe the economic growth in our city is going to be down in large part to the work of the BRA. However, I've got to say, the Boston Redevelopment Authority needs to be very, very careful with all this development because you could become the Boston Overdevelopment Authority. Thank you.
Cities that have successfully activated their roads.
visitors and the waterfront.
Good evening, folks. My name is Ron. development we have now. If it wasn't for water developments, you wouldn't be here. Guess what? You want to stay?
Level quality traffic analysis that can be shared and that has
raised talking point of this is a dilapidated area. This is our home. I raised three kids in that home. We attended many of the shops go to, we have friends, church, St. Leonard's, etc. So all I can hope at this point is that I can trust the DRA. And that would become evidence whether or not they make a decision on flimsy data, half-baked promises with no enforcement. That remains to be seen. I think Chris has done a nice job with these meetings, and I only hope that we can earn the kind of trust that we as residents in this area and in this commonwealth
Also, if you go out to our
seems to be in the bag. Lower buildings, at the end of the historic wars, there were small buildings. That's the way it was 200 years ago, when these were 150 years ago, when these were gorgeous buildings. It cascaded down in that architecture. This will be the only example of us as Boston, as the Boston public, going backwards and putting high-rise buildings against the water and the front of the historic buildings. That's my big problem.
Here.